In March of 1989, a solar eruption caused blackouts across Canada and malfunctions on board the space shuttle.
We've been seeing some erratic pressure signatures out of Tank 3, as well as some manifold pressure spikes in that system.
11 years later, the sun emitted a flare that was so powerful, it blinded the solar fleet's sensors. 11 years after that, Earth had a near miss with the most powerful coronal mass ejection ever recorded.
The sun has a very predictable, but actually quite mysterious cycle of activity. It gets very, very active every 11 years, and then it settles back down to more of a peaceful existence.
This 11-year cycle has astronomers scratching their heads. One thing we do know is that violent solar events seem to be preceded by dark patches on the solar surface. Sunspots.
Sunspots are large areas on the surface of the sun, much bigger than the Earth, that are caused by incredibly strong magnetic fields disrupting the flow of plasma.
And every 11 years, these dark spots grow in number, like clouds gathering before a storm.
When you start seeing more and more sunspots, there's an expectation that you're going to see more intense and more frequent solar flares.
But what drives this 11-year cycle?
It's kind of ironic that one of the most predictable things about the sun is also the most mysterious.
We've been puzzling over the sunspot cycle for generations, and now finally we have spacecraft headed to the sun to try to give us some answers.
The SOHO, SDO, and STEREO spacecraft monitor the sun's atmosphere using ultraviolet telescopes. They spot flashes of high-energy, ultraviolet light moving across the sun. These waves of light could be connected to the cycle of sunspots and to the sun's outbursts, because everything we see on the sun's surface is controlled by violent processes deep in its interior.
The sun is a very simple onion. At the very, very center is the core where the nuclear fusion happens. A layer surrounding that is known as the radiative zone, where most of the energy gets pushed out through radiation. Then surrounding that is something called the convective zone, where there's great plumes and chains of plasma moving up and down, up and down.
But unlike an onion, the layers spin.
There are currents inside the sun that we don't see from the surface. Layers of the sun deep down inside are rotating at different rates than the layers above.
So it turns out the inner part of the sun is rotating at maybe 3 times more rapidly than the outer part of the sun. We also can see on the outer part of the sun that the equator is rotating more rapidly than the pole.
These layers of plasma grinding against each other generate the sun's enormously powerful magnetic field and give rise to sunspots, plasma loops, and solar flares.
This differential rotation takes the field and starts twisting it around the sun. So as the magnetic field gets too twisted, it starts knotting up and these knots start bubbling up to the surface, and that's what we're seeing actually with the sunspots.
And that's why you see all these wonderful loops and prominences coming off the sun. Once the magnetic fields start twisting and interacting, they can direct the plasma into vast rivers and loops, both above and below the surface of the sun.
Why these events flare up every 11 years is a mystery. But now, new observations from the solar fleet could provide a clue about what triggers the solar cycle. Giant, moving magnetic fields beneath the sun's surface.
We think that the ultraviolet light flickers are telling us where the magnetic field is.
In the course of the 11-year cycle, the sun's magnetic fields begin to move down from the poles, closer and closer to the equator.
As the magnetic field lines move through the star, they carry huge amounts of plasma with them.
The magnetic field lines act like shepherds for the plasma underneath the surface, and they push plasma down to the equator of the sun.
The magnetic fields trap enormous amounts of plasma, like water behind a dam, until eventually the floodgates open and the plasma comes rushing out.
When the magnetic fields meet, they cancel each other out and release the plasma, which goes as a tsunami wave back to the poles.
When that plasma rebounds from the equator and hits the magnetic field coming down from the poles at the mid-latitudes, you get a huge burst of magnetic activity.
Magnetic activity that triggers sunspots and loops also explains the 11-year cycle.
We think that this relationship between the magnetic fields, the ultraviolet flickers, and the plasma drives the 11-year cycle. We think this is what's actually doing the work.
The solar cycle has wound down for now. But once the next plasma tsunami rushes through the sun, our star will kickstart into action again.
Over the next few years, we're going to start to see more sunspots, more activity, more flares, more ejections, and more space weather that we have to deal with.
We often think of space as being empty, but in fact, we are bathed in a wind, a million mile an hour wind of high energy particles from the sun all the time, the solar wind.
A stream of subatomic particles called photons constantly flow out from the sun in all directions, bombarding the planets of our solar system.
The solar wind is so strong when it hits Mercury that it can break down some of the minerals and rocks on its surface into their constituent parts. And those parts, especially if they have oxygen in them, can go to reform and form water, which, if it forms in the right place, can then stick around.
The solar wind has a tremendous impact on the worlds of our solar system. We think it's responsible for the planet Venus becoming this hellhole of heat.
Up until as recently as 700 million years ago, Venus was a lush water world with conditions suitable for life. The solar wind blasted away the water vapor and oxygen from Venus's atmosphere, leaving carbon dioxide to dominate, trapping the sun's heat and causing surface temperatures to skyrocket. Mars was once habitable too. But the solar wind quickly took care of that as well.
We believe that billions of years ago, Mars had an atmosphere and had oceans and rivers. It looked a lot like Earth. It was gorgeous. But that solar wind stripped away the Martian atmosphere and turned it into the barren wasteland that it is today.
And Earth is in the line of fire too. It's bombarded every day with solar wind particles. So, how has life survived?
One of the things we really take for granted is how well protected we are here on the Earth. The atmosphere absorbs a lot of harmful things from space and from the sun as well, but also our magnetic field deflects the solar wind around us, and we still have an atmosphere.
And when the charged particles come from the sun, the magnetic field lines trap those charged particles and redirect them to the poles of the planet.
The physical effect, the direct physical effect of getting bombarded by these particles, they can generate the aurora borealis, the northern lights, and these are spectacular and beautiful.
Auroras are beautiful, but they're also the front line in the battle between Earth and the solar wind. Without our protective shield, we'd suffer the same fate as Venus or Mars.